Hi, and welcome to my channel, and welcome to the first in my new series of building a 7.5, or for you in the US, 5x7, camera from scratch. Let's get into it. But Ash, I hear those of you who regularly look at the channel cry, you've already got a 7x5 camera. You've got the lovely old European travel camera, which I built a back for and which I've taken quite a few images on now. And yes, I do, and it's great. But it has one disadvantage, well, a couple of disadvantages. It's relatively delicate because it's an antique, and it also has very, very few movements. In fact, it's only got one movement, and that's rise and fall on the front standard. I actually quite like using movements, and hence I have my trusty MPP Micro Technical behind me, which is in one sense an ideal for me, but it doesn't have the facility to take 5x7. So the thought was born to produce something that could take 5x7 and have a full set of movements. Now, when designing a camera, many people start, in fact most people start, from the film holder and work outwards or forwards. For me, I'd already designed a film holder system that I built, and that's in previous videos, I'll give a link to, for this camera. So I didn't need to do that bit. The main thing I had to do was to show that I could build what I consider to be the heart of a view camera successfully, and that is the Bellows. Now, I've got quite a lot of cameras amongst my collection to have Bellows, right? From this travel camera, my MPP, through to this old girl, which is a Thornton Picard that needs a bit of work doing to it and needs its Bellows repaired at some stage. But the overriding thing with them all is that the Bellows is the real heart of the camera. Aside from the Bellows, it's a shallow box. See a front standard really is a shallow box and a baseboard. The bit that actually does all the work really, the Bellows. So I built a set of Bellows when I was in my teens. Wasn't super successful, I didn't really have the right materials for it, but I knew the basic principles, and I started to do some research. And I found a guy who was prepared to put sizes into a online app, and for a small fee, make you a Bellows design to your specifications. I'll put a link to that as well. And because I know what I want as far as the Bellows extensions concerned, and as far as the size when folded up, it made sense for me to start the design from the Bellows. And so I started by sourcing materials. After hunting around online a bit, I found a black waterproof rayon Tivoli fabric, which is this, and it has a impregnated side and a normal fabric side, and it's strong and it is absolutely totally light proof. And this is going to be the basis for my bellows. The other thing that has to be done for this is cutting of ribs, because bellows are composed, or most bellows, are composed of a rib that holds the bellows into shape. Over the top of the lining and on the outside is the actual bellows material. So, I had to, normally ribs are cut from card, which is fine, but it's an extremely laborious process. So, using my cunning and my workshop, I turned to my trusty laser cutter to produce the ribs. Let's have a look at that. This is the raw PDF as it comes down after you've paid your £4 or so, inputted all the details of the size you want your bellows to be at the rear standard end and at the front standard end, and how much extension you want. The software churns it all about and outputs this PDF file. Well, there's a lot of information in this PDF file I don't actually need, because all I'm going to be using it for is cutting the actual ribs. So it's difficult to see on this screenshot, but there are a lot of black lines on here, and it's only the red lines that define the ribs that I actually need. So I took this PDF into CorelDRAW and went through and systematically and quite laboriously deleted any of the black lines that I didn't need, until we just had the red lines that I did need. That could then be imported into my cutting software for my laser cutter, which I did, and I cut a small test piece just to check that everything was going to work well. Well, it was certainly cutting properly, but it was also going a little bit too slowly and causing too much soot and too much burn back. So I'd have to bear this in mind when I was actually cutting the real material, which I will now get onto. I want to stress you don't actually need all this technology. I could have actually drawn this out and used a scalpel knife. It would have taken a lot longer, but I could have done that. So please, if you're thinking about doing this, don't despair because you don't have all the technology. But anyway, I reduced down that big drawing into manageable A4 size bites, literally chopping it up so that I could do each face of the bellows in three sections. This will become a bit more obvious as you see things coming together. You see my little test piece there, held in register with some, it's a masking tape that modelers use. And I put that on there before I even removed the cut ribs from the waste material around it. So the waste material kept them in register. Again, that'll be easier to see on a full piece. So now we'll cut some of the genuine material. I always think that cutting with light is a really cool thing to do, and it's an even cooler thing to do if you're a photographer. I mean, you deal with light anyway, don't you? Anyway, this is showing cutting the ribs for, I believe, the top part of the bellows. The next bit you'll see is the ribs for the side of the bellows that are slightly different. They don't have that pointed bit on them. It becomes clear when you actually see it laid out how it all works. But it cut really, really easily and really quickly, and I sat back and had a cup of coffee while it did its thing.
with all 12 sections cut, you can see how I taped them using the waste material which I left on them, ready to transport back home, and assemble into the respective sides. Should be a fairly easy one, I thought at the time, which actually didn't prove to be too far from the truth. So once I got home, I got out a big pasting table, wallpaper pasting table that is, and I assembled the top of the bellows ribs and marked the borders out with some wide masking tape. I also put a masking tape hinge on the bottom end of this, and the widest part of the bellows, it's the bit at the top there that you'll see. This was so that I could flip the whole thing back, spray contact adhesive onto the black bit there, which is the inside of the bellows material. And speaking of contact adhesive, I found some cheap and cheerful mounting adhesive or spray contact adhesive at a local, it's a strange shop that sells absolutely everything. It's not really particularly branded, but it did the job perfectly well. I bought two huge cans and I only actually used half a can. So I took my courage in both hands, flipped back the ribs with their hinge, and sprayed the back of the fabric with spray adhesive. You'll notice that I've used brown paper to mask it going on other bits because I don't want those sprayed yet. And the next bit was to flip the ribs forward again, aligning them very, very carefully with the edge of the masking tape and smoothing them down. Here you can see I've done the top and one of the sides. You have to be particularly careful when you line up the corners of the sides to leave enough room so that the fabric can actually flex. I used some narrow bits of card glued together to kind of make a spacing gauge for them. Another little tip that I'd give is make sure you have plenty of pairs of disposable gloves on hand, because contact adhesive doesn't just get where you want it to get, it gets absolutely everywhere. I mask everything up really, really carefully, as you can see, and I'm just really careful, and as soon as I get any contact adhesive on my gloves, I throw the gloves away and put on another pair, because otherwise your fingers get stuck to your fingers and your fingers get stuck to everything else and it turns into a total mess, and you can mark the good side of the bellows fabric, which you don't want to be doing. We're at quite a delicate stage here. I'm laying out the last closing side, the bottom of the bellows ribs, and I only want the glue to go on half of the ribs and half of the backing, because that's going to be the closing side. So you'll see I've got a brown paper mask underneath, and I'll mask half of the ribs when I spray those. It becomes a bit clearer when you see the next bit. And there we have it glued on with only half of the ribs actually glued down. So we have a closing side, we have a short amount of fabric on the right hand side there and a long on the left, so that the covering can overlap by about an inch when the bellows are closed up. Before we can close them up, we have to put a lining on them. And the lining is a soft, thin black cotton. It doesn't have to be light tight. It just stops wear to the ribs and makes everything look nice on the inside. I simply spray that with the contact adhesive and carefully lay it on the top and smooth it out, as you can see. My apologies for a lack of photographs in bringing the sides together, but trying to handle the spray mounting, well, spray adhesive, holding everything together, bringing it all into alignment, and holding a camera really wasn't possible. So when you glue the outer material layer onto the closing side, what you get is this long tube, which I then had to very carefully use the spray adhesive inside on the closing panel to bring the lining material together. Used a couple of pieces of wood to mask in there when I sprayed. And then the whole thing more or less folded itself, because it's actually got the shape already in it from the ribs. So once you know where the sides are going, it's quite a quick matter to fold them, but it does make your fingers ache. And what you end up with is this.
So at the end of that process, what we have here is a fully completed, strong, light, tight bellows that looks, I think, pretty professional. And it's going to be very, very hard wearing, being a three-layer construction, very tough, suitable for the rigors of being rained on and being thrown into a bag and all the things that a 755 camera has to go through with me. Anyway, if you've enjoyed this so far and you'd like to follow along with this mini-series, or indeed the photo lounge in general, then hit that like button and ring the bell, and perhaps consider subscribing. And I always love hearing from you in the comments, so if you have any ideas about other elements that I can incorporate into the design of the 75, then let me know. And anyone else who wants to follow along and build something similar, please, always willing to help, message me and I'll tell you anything I possibly can. So, until next time, take care and keep taking pictures. Bye.